The statutes of the Lord are trustworthy, making wise the simple. The precepts of the Lord are right, giving joy to the heart. The commands of the Lord are radiant, giving light to the eyes. The fear of the Lord is pure, enduring forever. The ordinances of the Lord are sure and altogether righteous. And then from Daniel chapter 2, starting at 27, Daniel replied, "No wise man, enchanter, magician, or divinator can explain to the king the mystery he has asked about, but there is a God in heaven who reveals mysteries. He has shown King Nebuchadnezzar what will happen in the days to come. Your dream and the visions that pass through your mind as you lay on your bed are these." May God add his blessing to the reading, both from Psalms and Daniel this morning. If you would, if you'll take your Bible or the Pew Bible out, if you don't have any issue with doing that, I think we should start with the table of contents. Today we're going to try to figure out, is this book true? Is the Bible true? You know, we're in the middle, just starting these God questions. Week 2 last week, is God real? And we presented some reasons why we believe God is real. Today we're asking the question, is the Bible true? And some would say that the Bible is mysterious. And we might answer that there are some mysteries in the Bible, but it's not a mysterious book. In fact, if we look at the Bible, if we look at the table of contents of the Bible, it's very ordered. So if you look, and if you have your own Bible, you might want to write in it. If you have feelings that you shouldn't write your Bible, please don't write in it. I think you should write all over your Bible. But we see in the table of contents, clearly the Bible is broken into two sections. It's not just one book, really, is it? It's a collection of 66 books. And those 66 books are ordered. We've got them broken. Old Testament, New Testament. Old Testament, 39 books. New Testament, 27 books. And when we break down the Testaments, those also were ordered. So if you look at the Old Testament, it starts with Genesis. Should be the first book in your table of contents. If you go from Genesis to Esther, that group are the history section of the Old Testament. So that is the history. And if you start then after Esther is Job. And Job through Song of Songs. See, that might say Song of Solomon in some of your Bibles. Those are the poetry books. Some would call them the wisdom books, the lyrical books. But poetry is what most people would call that section of books. And then, if you go from Isaiah all the way to Malachi, those are your prophecy books. Those are books that are written on words that were given to people who wrote it down as prophecy. So they are called the prophets. Now, if we go to the New Testament, it also is ordered. And so how it is ordered, if we look at the first books of the New Testament, we look at the first book is Matthew, right? Matthew in everybody's book? Okay. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts. Those are the history books. Those are the history books of the New Testament. Then we move, after Acts comes Romans. So if we go from Romans all the way to Jude, big section. See that? Romans all the way, probably even goes to a new column. All the way to Jude. Those are called the letters. Those are letters that were written to new, small, beginning churches. These were letters that were written. And then we have the last book, Revelation, which is the prophecy. So again, we have history, letters, and prophecy, and that is how the Bible is ordered. And so we have to look at that order, and it has some meaning. Now, if you think, well, I'm going to start at Genesis, and I'm going to read the Revelation, and I'm going to understand the Bible story. Yeah. I'm sorry, it's not chronological. So it's really going to be back and forth and up and down, and you're probably going to pull some of your hair out. It looks like some of you have read the Bible because your hair is back. Well, and mine's getting there as well. So let's get into it. Who wrote the Old Testament? Who wrote the Old Testament? We have to look at that because maybe that would give us, and when was it written? Maybe that would give us some ideas whether it is true. Well, if we look at when it was written, we might actually find out that Job was the first book written. Job is what a lot of scholars believe to be the oldest book. And if you look at the chronological Bible, most of them will have Genesis, Job, in chronological order. Now, Job's closest rival to those scholars who say Job may have written it is Moses. And we know that Moses did write those first five books. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. But we know he didn't write the last chapters of Deuteronomy. Why? Because it's his death. Right. So who wrote about Moses' death? Probably Joshua, who was the heir apparent, the person that was chosen to take Moses' place. And Joshua has his own book that he wrote. So we have Moses and Job, who were probably the writers, probably 1900 B.C. is when Job may have been written. And there's thoughts that when Moses wrote Genesis, he wrote it because there were a lot of oral teachings going on. Now remember, both in antiquity and in the Old Testament, oral teachings were preferred over any writing that came later. If you wrote something down, you're probably not telling the truth. That was their thought. But if I'm orally teaching you, it probably is true. It's a little different than us today. We buy a house, we buy a car, you better sign a whole myriad of paperwork, because if you don't sign it, if it's not in writing, we don't believe it's true. The old handshake doesn't work anymore. So Moses writes these first five books, and then Joshua starts to write. And there were people in the 1800s that said, you know, he couldn't have written, because there was no writing then. How does Moses write a book when there was no writing? And then, in 1901, a couple French philosophers, archaeologists, actually found some writing that they could verify was from 1795 B.C. The Code of Hammurabi. You can see pictures of it. You can actually go and see it. It's in a museum where it's the actual first dating of writing. 1795 B.C. We move into Deuteronomy and we find out how these writings were preserved. How were they secured? Deuteronomy 31:26 says that there was a tabernacle that was first constructed, and the writing of Moses was placed in the Ark of the Covenant. And the Ark of the Covenant, which was a wooden box with gold on the outside of it. And it's where God was. And it's where Moses put the Ten Commandments. And any other writings that Moses did, he placed in the Ark of the Covenant, which was placed in the Holy of Holies. The Holy of Holies was the only place where God was, and the only people that go to see him was the priest that could go in to the Holy of Holies. That's where God was. That's where they kept the scriptures that were written at the time. Then when the temple was built, they moved the Ark of the Covenant into the temple, because the tabernacle was something that moved. And if you read the Old Testament, you can get into the details of how the tabernacle was built, and how tall and how wide. And then the temple was built and was moved in there. And even Samuel, who was a judge, his writing, First Samuel, which you see in here, was deposited in the Ark of the Covenant. 1 Samuel 10:25 writes, "He wrote them down on a scroll and deposited them before the Lord." And we know the Lord was in the Ark of the Covenant. Ruth, Judges, those books also part of it. And there were other writers that we don't have books about that wrote during that time. Nathan, Gad were also people that wrote during that time. So we know we have names that we recognize. We have names like Jeremiah and Ezra. Then these people wrote as well. Jeremiah was a prophet. He completed the Book of Kings. Also wrote the Book of Lamentations and wrote his own book, the Book of Jeremiah. Ezra completed the Book of Chronicles. Ezra also helped Nehemiah write the book of Nehemiah. Mordecai wrote the book of Esther. Half of the Psalms are credited to King David. The Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, Song of Songs are credited to David's son, King Solomon, who came after David. He wrote those. There's also a Talmud that is an authoritative Jewish writing that was credited Josephus. And we look back at Josephus' writings to corroborate a lot of what I have just said. The Old Testament scriptures placed in the Ark of the Covenant were destroyed. We know that the temple was destroyed and the original copies of these writings were lost. So a lot of skeptics, a lot of those that choose not to believe, will hang their hat on, well, it's not the original writings that you're getting it from, and so it just can't be true. But what we find in our research is that there were other copies made of the original that were moved around from place to place for people to read. And those original copies were very, very well done. I'll talk about that later. And so we go all the way to Malachi, and then it goes silent, doesn't it? We have this time period that's called the testamental period, that has 400 years of where we don't have writing. But there was some writing. And the Catholic Bible, those of you that have grown up in the Catholic Church know that as the what? The Apocrypha. Right? And you can read those stories. And a lot of them are very good. They're just not canonized. They weren't deemed to have enough witnesses to corroborate the writing to put them in the Bible. Doesn't mean they're not true. And the stories are great, and I think they're worth reading. Who wrote the New Testament? Well, we see that about half of the New Testament was written by Paul. And Paul wrote the New Testament in letters to these new and exciting churches that he was starting and others that followed him would start. And so he wrote about half of that. Luke, who was a physician, a doctor, he wrote the book of Luke and Acts. And Luke and Acts was really one book. It was divided later on by church fathers, several hundred years after Christ. But Luke and Acts could really be read as one book. The Apostle John wrote five books. Now this is John, like the Gospel of John. That John. He wrote John, the Gospel. He wrote the first, second, and third letter of John, which you'll see at the end of the New Testament. And he also wrote the prophetic book of Revelation. He wrote five books. We know that two were written by Peter. And if you want to research that, you can find that 2 Peter. There's some controversy about whether he read it because the style is so different. But Peter also had a heavy hand in writing Mark. And that's John Mark, who the Gospel of Mark. Mark wrote one book. And then the remaining books, Matthew wrote one. And then Jesus' half-brothers, James and Jude, wrote books of the New Testament. Now there's one book that we don't have an author for, Hebrews. Many believe Hebrews was a sermon. It may have been given by Paul. It may have been given by Apollos. It may even been given by my personal favorite choice would be. It was given by Priscilla. But we couldn't give any women credit there because of the gender bias of the day. And so there really is not one author given. And it may have been a combination of those three. They were good friends. They did a lot of work together. So it could have been all three of them that had a hand in writing Hebrews. But all of the New Testament books were written between 46 A.D. and 90 A.D. 46 and 90. What's this mean to you? Well, if we believe Ephesians, if we believe Paul's letter to Ephesus, to those people there, this new church there, he tells them that this scripture that he's teaching is built on the foundation of the apostles and the prophets. This book is built on the apostles and the prophets with Christ Jesus as the chief cornerstone of all of it. So the Bible claims authority on many, many factors. And one of them is authorship. The people that wrote the Bible. Each of the 66, written by either a prophet or an apostle. A prophet is somebody who was witnessed by, confirmed by other human beings to have been spoken to by God and was able to write down what God told him. These are not people who just said that God spoke to them. These were people that witnessed and had their credentials recognized, affirmed by their contemporaries. Prophets. The apostles are those that had face-to-face encounters with Jesus Christ. So either you were spoken to by God and was affirmed and confirmed by your contemporaries, or you had a face-to-face encounter with Jesus Christ. That's who wrote the Bible. Authorship is important. So how's the Bible, other than that, how's the Bible different than other books? A lot of people say the Bible is unique. You'll hear a lot of people say that, quoted as that. Well, it was the first book ever printed on a printing press. Gutenberg actually invented the printing press so he could reprint the Bible. And when he did, the Bible was the book that was first print was 1.2 million copies, and all 1.2 million were spoken for before the first one was printed. The Bible was the first book translated into another language. The Greeks took the Hebrew and turned it from the Hebrew language into the Greek language, and what we read when we read the Greek New Testament is called the Septuagint. And just a little side note, in seminary, when I was taught the Old and New Testament by four different professors, they read from the Hebrew in the Old Testament and the Septuagint, the Greek, in the New Testament. Man, what a gift to be able to do that. And so you learn exactly what the meanings of some of those words and phrases are from those learned scholars, men or women. There was a famous agnostic in the 1960s, there always is, there's famous agnostics today, those that recognize there is a God, it's just not important to me. Josh McDowell in the 1960s, you may know of him, he was a huge person in Campus Crusade for Christ later on when he found Jesus Christ. But he, as an agnostic, decided because he was an intelligent guy, he wanted to research this Bible. Is it true? Is it real? Is it what they say it is? And he came out with, Bible is the most unique piece of literature in all of history. And he went on to break it down five ways. Its continuity, its circulation, its translation, its survival, and its teaching make it unique to every other book ever written. He said, if you are an intelligent person and you are searching for truth, you will read this one book. And it will draw your attention more than anything else you can read. Continuity. The continuity of the Bible, you have, even if you decide not to read it or decide it's not important, the continuity of the Bible is nothing less than impressive, maybe even amazing. The Bible addresses many, many subjects of controversy. Yet, it seems to agree substantially on all of those controversies. Even though the book's written over centuries ago, there's one progressive theme that goes from Genesis to Revelation, and that theme is God wants a relationship with mankind. Some would say that love is from Genesis to Revelation. That's the thread that connects all the books. But for sure, relationship between God and mankind is paramount throughout all 66 books. Can you imagine today picking 40 authors, all speaking the same language, maybe all living in the same town, And let's give them some things to see if they could write on it and agree. How about stem cell? Terrorism? How about health care? And get all of them to agree. To have continuity throughout. I think it would be difficult, but the Bible is able to accomplish that. Circulation. The Bible is the best-selling book of all time. It has been the number one selling book since 1900? Hey, 1455. Bibles are numberless. And from 1810 to 1990, the International Bible Society has given away or sold 300 million copies of the Bible in 450 different languages. During the attacks of 9/11 in New York, 800,000 copies were donated and distributed in the New York City area after this attack. Translation. As of 2014, the Bible's been translated into 2,883 different languages. 2,883 different languages, representing 95% of the population in the entire world. The goal is to accomplish that last 5% by 2025. That every language ever spoken will have a Bible in their language. Think about that. What other book can we name that comes anywhere close to that? Survival. Now we know that the Bible is written on papyrus, vellum, and paper, which are all what? Perishable items. They're all perishable. Yet it's been recopied countless numbers of times in the last 3,500 years. Here's a couple quotes from John Warwick Montgomery, who was a Lutheran theologian, legal expert, philosopher, wrote a lot of books on Christian thought. Jews preserved the scripture as no other manuscript has ever been preserved. With their masorah, which is a method of counting, they kept tabs on every letter, syllable, word, and paragraph. They had special classes of men within their culture whose sole duty was to preserve and transmit these documents with practically perfect fidelity. That's all their job was to preserve these hallowed scriptures. And if we're skeptical of the New Testament books, if we're skeptical, and that means we allow really all classical antiquity to be in question, because this is the one that was watched over, cared for, and identified by special classes of people to be right. So what does that say about others that weren't cared for that way? And we know that from Rome to the Islamic states today, there is no book that's been under more scrutiny. Burned, banned, outlawed, restricted, yet it remains the most widely circulated and read book of the day. Is it unique in its teaching? What is unique of it? Because it will identify controversies. It will actually expose itself to prophecy and make specific predictions about the future. There have been 2,500 prophecies identified in the Bible, and 2,000 of those prophecies have come to be. There's about 500 prophecies left in the Bible that have been identified by scholars that have yet to happen, but they have been predicted. It teaches us that antiquity had some accurate writers who were influenced greatly, and I will tell you who by. And miracles are talked about. Just think about it. Think about if you're sitting at your apartment complex or your home, and you're sitting by your pool, and all of a sudden you hear some rumbling in the water, and the pool parts. And there's dry parts of your pool right down the center. You would come to church and say, I was sitting by the umbrella table, I was drinking a drink, I was reading a book, it was really warm outside, and I saw this rumble in the water, you know, the clouds started to change a little bit. You would really make this a really great story with a lot of adjectives. Here's how the Bible writes about the parting of the Red Sea. Exodus 14:21. Check me. And the Israelites went through the sea on dry ground with a wall of water on the right and a wall of water on the left. So it doesn't flower the miracles. It doesn't make them out to be, I have to show you this miracle, so let me really flower it up. Let me give you a lot of detail and adjectives about this. No, it just was dry ground, the wall part, the walls of water on the right and the left. It's just the way the Bible does it. It doesn't have to give you all that. And it tells about their heroes. Who are our heroes? Abraham. David, right? Good people of the Bible. We quote them wrong. Moses. But what does the Bible tell you? Abraham was dishonest. Moses was reluctant. David committed adultery. Peter denied. Paul persecuted the church. He worked against those that believed. So it offers us motivation. Because we have done some of those things. John 8. John, remember he wrote 5 books. John 8:32. Then you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. The pages of the Bible entice us. The more you read it, the more it says, calls you. Come read more. Come experience me more. Come look at my words. Come know, understand the people in here. Because the more you read it, someday, reading something somewhere, a light will come on. It may be years, it may be months, but a light will come on. And we'll understand that this is the book, this is the instruction book for my life, this is the book I need to be reading. I can read all kinds of other books. I should read all kinds of other books. But I really need to read this book. I need to understand this book. Because we understand that the Bible is the most accurately translated book of all time. In fact, they're so accurate, they've been moved from one generation to the other. The documentation is there from one generation to the other. People that continue to look at the translation say, this is so brilliant, God must have been involved. It's that good. And these are people that do this for a living, that understand translating words from one to the other. They understand that this is amazing. Because it was translated from original language. Old Testament, 99% Hebrew. The New Testament, Aramaic and Greek. And when you look at the manuscripts, what they found was even these translations, because they've been done so well, are even better than the ancient documents that they found. What's that mean? It means by standards of scholarly accuracy and reliability, the Bible is head and shoulders above any other literature in history. In fact, they say half of 1% of the words of the Bible are in question. And none of those change the doctrine of Christianity. Now, well, Pastor, that's great. That's great. I understand that it's been translated. That's good. You know, I really need proof. I'm one of those guys, from Missouri. You really got to show me this stuff. I don't really believe in theories or hypothesis. Or sometimes even logic isn't enough for me. We need actual proof. And the great thing about God is he's not offended by that. He's not even alarmed by that. People said the earth was flat. The Bible said the earth was a sphere. People said the number of stars in the sky measured 1,100. The Bible said the number of stars in the sky were billions. We know who's right. All stars are the same as what people said. Now the Bible said every star was different. We know who's accurate there. People said light is in a fixed place. The Bible says light is in motion. People said air is weightless. The Bible said air has weight. We know who's right on these. People said the wind blows straight. The Bible says the wind blows in cyclones. We know who's right. People said to heal, you must bleed a person. The Bible says blood is the source of healing. When's the last time you've gone to the doctor and he's made you bleed?
Yeah.
Blood is the source of healing. Not only that, if you want to go on, the Bible describes conservation of mass and energy. It talks about the cycle of evaporation, condensation, precipitation. It talks about gravity and how it handles the bound star groups to gravity, the effects of emotions on physical health, the spread of disease by close contact, the importance of sanitation to health. What grade do you give to a book like this? Oh, and by the way, it's done over 2,000 years ago. Robert Jastrow, who was a NASA scientist, also a futurist. This is a great quote. We'll wake up for this one. If you didn't hear anything, you got to hear this quote. He's a skeptic now. He's a NASA astronomer. Okay? For the scientist who lives by the faith in the power of reason. Okay? If you're one of those, the story ends like a bad dream. The scientist is about to conquer the highest peak of scientific truth. And just as he pulls himself over the final rock, he's greeted by a band of theologians who have been there for centuries. That's what you find when you research the Bible, because we have such great archaeology on it. We have all this data that's been uncovered. We have all these people doing great studies. And we're able to measure the Bible historically a lot more accurate than we ever have been. I was talking on the back porch with my son and his significant other, and We were talking about things in the Bible, and I just gave an easy one. And one of them was that engineers said if the Jericho wall actually did fall down, it fell in. So the Bible must be wrong, because the Bible says the walls fell out. But engineers have gone and studied and actually found where the walls were and have done through their engineering and archaeological tests and found and actually verified and swore to a signed statement, the walls did indeed fall out. That's something. The Pool of Bethesda, for years, was not there. There's no Pool of Bethesda. It's just a great story in the Bible. Probably was no healing pool. Probably nobody ever did bathe in it. Until 1888, they excavated the Pool of Bethesda, and you could go visit it today. Prophecy. From Moses to Malachi, there have been prophecies about the spiritual health of Israel. So how do we know that these prophets actually heard from God? Well, we have examples from Isaiah, who was a prophet, who predicted the fall of Jerusalem 100 years before it happened and named the ruler that would set them free. 100 years before it happened. Now, let's make it easy. Can you imagine an American president predicting foreign policy 100 years from now? You got faith in that? Ezekiel, if you read the book of Ezekiel, chapter 26 will tell you similar predictions that came true 200 years after he said it. So was the Bible written by God or by men? 2 Peter 1, 20, 21. Above all, you must understand that no prophecy of Scripture came about by the prophet's own interpretation of things. For prophecy never had its origin in the human will, but prophets through humans spoke from God as they were being carried along by the Holy Spirit. We see in Exodus, it says, write these words. God says to Moses, write these words down. In Jeremiah, he says, the word of the Lord came to me. But in Luke says, I decided to write. So which is it? Is it God or man? There's a Greek word, theopnestos. That word we translate as God breathed. We've probably heard that and seen that where all of Scripture is what God breathed. Probably heard that. But really, what it means, if you go to the ancient Greek, again, this I was taught this, I don't know this. It really means God exhaled. God breathed out his prophecy to men. God breathes out what he wants people to hear and act upon. And so Peter affirms that the scripture was written because men were moved to write what God told them to write. Isaiah wrote with confidence. Jeremiah wrote with sorrow. John used very simple Greek. Luke used more technical language because he was a doctor. And we know the Bible's written in different prose, don't we? Some poetry like Psalm. Some in parables and riddles like Proverbs. Some in satire and allegory like Matthew. And some in hyperbole like Galatians. Why so much variety? Why so much? Because God allowed humans to take part in the writing, to play a role in the style of how the Bible is written. God supervised the content, but he allowed men to choose their own style uniquely to that person. So is it true? I think it's true that God did inspire the writers. I think it's true today when we write things in our church environment or for others that we can be inspired by the Holy Spirit, that actually the Holy Spirit will take words that we say and turn them in a way that you hear them and so that you can move forward in your life. I believe the Bible to be true. I don't want anybody walking out of here today wondering that question. You can question my scholarly aptitude. You can question my intelligence. You can question my style. But don't question for a minute that I don't think this book is true. God's creativity allows different groups to be inspired because 40% of the Bible is stories. 40% of the Bible allows us to paint pictures so people can understand the story and move forward with it. Chuck Swindoll used to paint pictures for me where I could feel the sand on my feet and the salt air on my face when he was talking and telling a story. Oh, I live for the day when I can do that for somebody. The New Testament talks on instruction. It speaks truth straight towards us. It's direct on the issues of theology and behavior. The prophetic literature requires concentration to understand. Doesn't it, John Shepherd, when we're reading the Minor Prophets?
Of course.
John's favorite book is Ezekiel. Poetic literature, we must be read slowly to understand the words and the nuances of the day. Apocalyptic literature unleashes an imagination like people that like science fiction. The same kind of writing for apocalyptic scripture. Some believe the Bible to have every type of literature that you will find in Barnes & Noble are in this book. So in the composition of the Scripture of God, he breathed, or better yet, he exhaled. He exhaled those words to communicate into the minds of the people, the minds of us, all that he had prepared for us. So in this way, words, forms, concepts, all that were written down were fully his, fully theirs, and now, because of the glory of God, fully ours. If you're going to start reading the Bible, start with the Gospel of Mark. It's short. It's 16 chapters. Read it first. Then go to Matthew, then maybe Luke and Acts before you tackle John. If you're going to read the Old Testament, start with Genesis because it is the beginning. And then maybe go to Deuteronomy because it sums up the first four books in one book. Next week, does all of this, all the roads lead to heaven, or is it just this? We're going to talk about that next week. Thank you all for giving your attention for a little longer than maybe you were bargaining for. But understand, we preach an instructional book here. That is true. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.